Liberty is Sweet, The Hidden History of the American Revolution by Woody Holton. Read by Shaun Taylor-Corbett. Words and Boundaries. Jeff Ward's two-page map at the start of this book differs from many depictions of Eastern North America in the 18th century in showing the boundaries between Native nations as well as European colonies. But it is worth remembering that, as with Europeans and settlers, Native American neighbors often disagreed about where exactly the lines ran, and even agreed-upon boundaries disguised considerable intermingling, as will be seen throughout the book. Liberty is Sweet identifies indigenous people by their nation, be it Cherokee, Shawnee, or what have you, whenever the sources provide it, but they do not always do so. Moreover, during the Revolutionary Era, disparate Native nations often coalesced, or tried to. In those cases, should they be referred to as Indians, Native Americans, or what? To call people who lived 8,000 miles from South Asia Indians, as the ever-hopeful Columbus did, is of course absurd. But Native American seems no better, since they reached these shores about 30,000 years before Amerigo Vespucci. And for my generation, at least, even natives reeks of the natives are restless. Indigenous, the term preferred in most of Latin America, people come up hundreds of times in this story, so simply for variety's sake, I follow their modern-day descendants in alternating among all these terms. Sometimes, when I have made my subject clear, I employ the Canadian term First Nations, which is dead-on accurate, but little known outside that country. I refer to the Native Americans who lived principally in what is now Alabama and Georgia, not as Creeks, as their British contemporaries did, and most historians do, but as Muscogees, the term they appear to have preferred, though even that masks the fact that they were, as Bernard Romans called them, a Confederacy of Remnants, the sole survivors of more than a dozen Native nations annihilated by European disease and slave traders. In addition to referring to African Americans and blacks, I occasionally talk about enslaved people, a term more and more historians are using to emphasize that slaves was what they were, not who they were. Finally, I faithfully preserve my sources' creative spelling and grammar, along with their often random capitalization. Prologue. An Invisible Enemy. July 1755. On July 2, 1775, when George Washington rode into Cambridge, Massachusetts to take command of the Continental Army, he expected to be attacked at any moment by the British soldiers camped across the Charles River in Boston and commanded by General Thomas Gage. Washington knew Gage. They had also fought 20 years earlier and 500 miles to the southwest near modern-day Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, only that time on the same side. In the Battle of the Monongahela on July 9, 1755, the 23-year-old Washington had served as an aide to the commander-in-chief of British forces in North America, Edward Braddock. Six other future Continental Army generals also served under Braddock, as did at least one colonist who would battle the Redcoats at Lexington and Concord. Gage led the advance troops. Daniel Boone drove a wagon and managed its woeful team. Benjamin Franklin did not accompany the army out to the Monongahela River, but did more than anyone to get it there. As the Redcoats waded north across the river, fewer than 300 French Marines and provincials, accompanied by more than 600 Native American warriors, marched down a hill toward them. Like their British counterparts, many of the French and Native survivors of this battle would fight again in the American War of Independence. The Battle of the Monongahela was the first major engagement of the world's first global war. Today, most Americans call it the French and Indian War, though in truth it drew in numerous additional belligerents as far away as India. In most of Europe, it is known as the Seven Years' War, though it actually dragged on for more than a decade. Canadians derived their term for it, the War of the Conquest, from one of its most dramatic outcomes. France ceded Quebec and the eastern half of the vast Mississippi Valley to Britain. Actually, though, Native Americans retained control over most of that region for the rest of the century. Exultant as they were at the outcome of the war, the British believed it had exposed fatal flaws in their relationship with their own North American colonists, and Parliament soon rolled out a package of imperial reforms. These British initiatives seemed tyrannical to the provincials, who contested every one of them. In a sense, the American Revolution, like the Seven Years' War, began on the banks of the Monongahela on July 9, 1755. So we would do well to start there too. It was fitting that Braddock fought the French and their Algonquin allies in Indian Country. In July 1755, as in July 1776, when 13 British colonies seceded from Britain, and in July 1861, when 11 rebel states defeated the rest in their first major encounter, the key to the controversy was Native American land. Today, West Virginia is known as the Mountain State, and Western Pennsylvania is just as hilly. But over the millennia, many of the region's streams, including the Ohio, carved out exceptionally fertile floodplains. In the Seven Years' War, as the empires of France and Great Britain fought in and over the upper Ohio Valley, they also had to contend with much older claimants, the Shawnees, Delawares, and Six Nations of the Iroquois, Senecas, Cayugas, Onondagas, Oneidas, Mohawks, and Tuscaroras. In 1753, France had attempted to strengthen its grip on the region by constructing a fort where the Monongahela and Allegheny Rivers converged to become the Ohio, modern-day Pittsburgh. The French post was known as Fort Duquesne, and Braddock's task was to destroy it and scatter, capture, or kill its garrison. Having served in the army for 45 of his 60 years, somehow without ever seeing combat, Braddock had acquired a reputation as a crack administrator. In March 1755, he landed his troops at Alexandria, Virginia, just across and down the Potomac River from modern-day Washington, D.C., where he was greeted by many of the colonists who would accompany him on his westward trek. One was an unabashed Anglophile named George Washington. He had been to the forks of the Ohio before. 2 years earlier, Washington had inveigled from Virginia Lieutenant Governor Robert Dinwiddie the hapless task of informing Jacques Le Gardeur de Saint-Pierre, the commander of French forces in the Trans-Appalachian region, that he and his soldiers were squatting on Virginia property and would have to leave. During the latter stage of his journey, Washington was accompanied by several Haudenosaunee, Iroquois. In a message to one of them, the half-king, viceroy, Tanagrisson, he laid claim to the name the Iroquois had bestowed upon his great-grandfather, John Washington. Cano Talcarius, devourer of villages. In his journal of the expedition, Washington referred to another of his Iroquois escorts, a young Seneca, as simply the hunter. His real name was Gayasuta, and his and Washington's paths would cross again. Washington's party reached Fort Leboeuf, the French headquarters on the Buffalo River, in what is now northwestern Pennsylvania, on December 11, 1753. Le Gardeur and his officers balanced their contempt for Governor Dinwiddie's outrageous demand with amused goodwill toward his earnest messenger. They loaded Washington down with ample food and drink for the trip home. The following year, the Virginian returned to the region, heading a party of provincial soldiers and Iroquois warriors and hoping to beat a French force to the forks of the Ohio. The French won the race, built Fort Duquesne, and sent a party to gather intelligence on Lieutenant Colonel Washington. On May 28, 1754, he and 40 Virginia provincials, goaded on by the anti-French Iroquois leader Tanagrisson, surprised and easily defeated the reconnoiterers, who were not expecting a war. But 5 weeks later, on July 4th, Washington and his troops had to surrender their outpost, Fort Necessity, to the French and their native allies, exchanging an abject confession of culpability for the privilege of going home. The following year, the news that Braddock was planning to attack Fort Duquesne by way of Virginia placed Washington in a quandary. He had long desired a commission in the British Army, and serving in the expedition would gain him valuable experience, contacts, and possibly renown. But an army regulation required provincial officers to take orders from regular officers of like rank, a humiliation he could not abide. When Braddock learned of Washington's dilemma and that the young Virginian knew the Upper Ohio Valley as well as any white man living. He offered him an unpaid place in his official family, personal staff, and Washington eagerly accepted. On April 12, 1755, the first of Braddock's soldiers set out from Alexandria on their westward journey through backcountry Virginia, Maryland, and Pennsylvania. The commander-in-chief expected to find 200 carts and 2,500 horses waiting for him in Frederick, Maryland, 50 miles to the northeast. Only 1/10 that number appeared, and one colonist reported that Braddock, in his fury, seemed more intent on an expedition against us than against the French. Pennsylvania's effort to supply the general had fallen victim to its internal divisions. The assembly would levy the necessary taxes only if the colony's largest landholders, the proprietary Penn family, would pay their share. But the Penn's hand-picked governor vowed to veto any tax on their land. Nonetheless, determined to combat the general's violent prejudices against Pennsylvania, and also to assist a second British army advancing up the Mohawk River, legislative leaders printed up £15,000 worth of paper currency to supply the troops. Meanwhile, Braddock commissioned Benjamin Franklin of Philadelphia to find him 150 wagons. In an advertisement that appeared in German as well as English, Franklin offered farmers silver and gold coin for the use of their wagons and teams. Describing Braddock's deputy quartermaster general, John St. Clair, as a hussar, one of the brutal light horsemen many Pennsylvanians thought they had left behind in the German states, Franklin assured them that whatever he was unable to buy, St. Clair would seize. Franklin did not appeal to his fellow colonists' British patriotism, an omission that was all the more surprising in light of the deep affection for the mother country that he shared with George Washington. Indeed, while Franklin loved his adoptive hometown of Philadelphia, it would take a sudden and last-minute Americanization to land him on the colonial side of the imperial divide just in time to help write the Declaration of Independence. Franklin had the farmers bring their wagons and horses to the junction of Wills Creek and the Upper Potomac River, the staging area for Braddock's ascent of the Allegheny Mountains. Years earlier, a group of wealthy Virginians and Marylanders, calling themselves the Ohio Company, had received a preliminary grant of up to 500,000 acres at the forks of the Ohio. The company also purchased animal pelts from Native American trappers and stored them at Wills Creek.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.